Okay, so let's go ahead and get started. The exam was a little bit on the tricky side, I'll admit, but you did quite well. The exam average is 58. Oftentimes on this exam, you know, you're looking at low 50s or so, and so you did quite well. It may not seem that way because thing is, these organic exams, they are tricky in that you might know what's going on, but there's so many little places to lose points, they all just add up. Okay. So, it's so confusing that this might be considered to be a good score, but it actually quite is. I will send out an email about what the grades are like, because I'm sure a lot of you are concerned about that. I'll send that out. I should be have enough time tonight to go through the statistics and show where people stand on that. Just approximate letter grades, that kind of thing. So, okay, let's hear. A problem set 16. I did not get it to the printer soon enough. Sorry. But it's being printed now. I will have hard copies outside my office, Tim, B3 78, starting around 11:30 or so. Oh, and a quick note, in case I forget, voter registration. There's a little booth outside on the lecture hall right out there. If you're eligible to vote and you haven't registered yet, please consider registering. I guess undergraduates and STEM majors have a very low participation rate in voting. That's what I'm told. So, kind of surprised me. Okay. So the next topic we're gonna cover. Is electrophilic aromatic substitution. And we're going to cover this topic before spring break and after spring break. And I realized that I forgot to mention something. Discussion sections on Friday are, it's the Friday before spring break. we are canceling the discussion sections on Friday. With that said, the TAs and I are going to be taking turns in Chem 1371. I'm starting at 11 o'clock and going to 5 o'clock. So if you have questions, we'll be in that room, okay? And so, but otherwise we figured that there might be less than normal attendance otherwise, especially at the later ones. So figured we would do it this way instead. So I'll send out an email to that effect as well. Got a lot of emails to send out. Okay. So, we're going to cover electrophilic aromatic substitution. I like to cover this before and after spring break because it's really the same reaction over and over and over again, and it's not too terribly taxing. It's a lot of it is actually review from NMR. It's also review from Chem 343. So, we have talked about alkenes in Chem 343. And this is sort of kind of the setup for this. You can have an addition reaction to an alkene. You protonate to form carbocation, the most stable carbocation you can form, and the nucleophile attacks. This is an addition reaction. All it really is just the reverse of the E1 elimination reaction. It's a reaction of an alkene. But benzene is different. Oops, getting ahead of myself. Bromine in an inert solvent with an alkene. End up getting two bromides in there. Benzene, on the other hand, no real detectable reaction. So the pi bonds on a benzene ring, even though they're pi bonds, don't quite behave like pi bonds do. Because benzene is pretty stable, it gets pretty hard to react with them. But it turns out you can force benzene to react with it if you have a strong enough electrophile. And the abbreviation for electrophilic aromatic substitution is EAS. We'll do both bromination and chlorination. But instead of just adding bromine to the benzene, if you add a Lewis acid, you can do the same thing with chlorine. You can actually force that benzene ring to react. These Lewis acids are the traditionally ones used for this reaction. But that doesn't mean they're the ones that you have to use. You can use other Lewis acids. You can even switch them around. ALBR 3 is fine. FECL 3 is fine. You can use BR 2 within ALCL 3 and you'll still get the bromine on there. Okay, so it's okay if you switch them around. The important part is they are Lewis acids. And what Lewis acids do is they make electrophiles better. So I'm only going to show the mechanism for one of these two. The other one you can figure out just by switching atoms. So which one do you want to see? Chlorination or bromination?
Chlorination.
Okay. So, the mechanism. And by the way, these electrophilic aromatic substitution reactions always follow the same pattern. Okay? The steps are form the electrophile. This may take one or two steps. Second step is to react to form the sigma intermediate. Get to that in just a moment. Third, deprotonate to restore aromaticity. All the EAS reactions we're going to have follow those three steps. So in the case of chlorination, the way we form the electrophile is the Lewis acidic aluminum complexes with one of the lone pairs on a chlorine. This is the first step. Okay?
We think of chlorine as a good leaving group. A chlorine with a positive formal charge, even better.
So that's the first step. The second step is you react to form the sigma intermediate. That's where the benzene ring comes in. And it's a good idea in benzene, if you're one of these people that draws circles in benzene, it's a good idea to stop doing that now. Start drawing the pi bonds. Another good idea is normally we don't draw in hydrogens. Here for electrophilic aromatic substitution, I highly suggest that you draw in the hydrogens. You don't have to, but I really suggest that you do it for this. Okay? So what we're going to do is we're going to substitute out this hydrogen for that chlorine. And the way we're going to do that is it's very similar to this first mechanism right here, where the double bond reaches out, forms a carbocation, It's very similar to that, and then it's the reverse of that. What I mean by that is the pi bond. You start the arrow at the pi bond, and it goes to the electrophile, and that kicks the leaving group off. And you get what's called the sigma intermediate. This sigma intermediate is resonance stabilized. But we have temporarily lost that benzene resonance. And benzene resonance is something that you don't want to lose. So this brings us to the second step. All the steps up to now have been reversible. This last step is irreversible, because what you're doing is you're forming benzene again. You're reforming the benzene resonance. Okay. Now, the way this step works is we're basically going to reform the benzene resonance by deprotonating. You start the arrow at the aluminum chloride bond. You don't start at the negative charge. You don't start it at the chlorine. You start at the bond, because what we're doing is we're simultaneously breaking the bond between the aluminum and the chloride. And then we're using those electrons to form the hydrogen chloride bond. And then the electrons from the hydrogen carbon bond become a new pi bond. And that regenerates your aluminum chloride. And the reaction starts again. Okay? Any questions on this? Yes. Why is it called a sigma intermediate? It's because this intermediate, this is the sigma intermediate. This intermediate right here
has an extra sigma bond. If it wasn't legible before, now it's completely illegible. Okay. That's my goal. Okay. Other questions? Okay. So bromination, same mechanism, except instead of Cls, you have Brs. And then you just swap out whatever Lewis acid you used in the mechanism. Hey. Now, electrophilic aromatic substitution starts to get a little bit trickier when you have groups already on the benzene ring. And let's put up the other one just for comparison purposes. Benzene. So we have here kind of a comparison. Depending on what substituent is on the ring, dictates where the chlorine goes. If it's an alkyl group, the chlorine ends up in a mixture of ortho and para. If it's an oxygen, it ends up ortho or para to that oxygen. If it's a carbonyl, it ends up meta. If we were to rank these in terms of reaction speed, in terms of fastest to slowest, one being fastest, four being the slowest. This one would be the fastest, followed by this one, followed by that one. Okay? So far? Okay. And I will say that this reaction right here is a bit of an exaggeration, that one. And we'll get to that in a bit. Okay? It's a bit of a lie, but we'll get to that. So, first thing I want to talk about is why some of them go para and some of them go meta. Some of them go ortho, okay? And there's two ways of explaining it. One's a pretty straightforward way, and then the other one is a more in-depth, detailed way. So, the straightforward way of thinking about it is you can think about it in terms of resonance. Remember from the NMR section, the methoxy group is an electron donating group. So we can kind of sum up that resonance by putting delta negatives in the ortho and the para positions. Those sites on the ring likely to have the highest electron density. Well, it's electrophilic aromatic substitution, making those the more likely site for the electrophile to add to. Okay? In the case of the carbonyl group is an electron withdrawing group.
That puts delta positive.
And the author on the para position.
Not electrons, electrophiles. So electrophiles are more likely to react with sites of high electron density. Electrophiles are less likely to react with sites of low electron density. So in the methoxy case, it likes to go ortho and para, because those are the sites of the delta negative. Carbonyl case, it doesn't want to go ortho and para because those are the delta positive, so it goes for the sites of the higher electron density, which is the neutral sites that we have according to resonance. Okay? This is also kind of explains about the relative reaction rate. The methoxy group is a much faster reaction than the carbonyl group is. Okay? In the case of that one, it's going for the delta negative. In the case of the carbonyl group, though, it's going for the lesser of two evils. Now, this is what's called activating. The bottom is what's called deactivating. Activating groups cause the benzene ring to react faster than normal benzene. Deactivating groups cause the benzene ring to react slower than normal benzene. And some of those you can just figure out by residents. Some of them you can't. Example of ones that you can't are alkyl groups. Yes. Alkyl groups are weakly activating. And to explain that, we're going to do sort of the generalized reaction. So, where E plus is just an electrifier. Okay. That's here. That's just a reminder to me. We'll get back to that. So to show that, we're going to take a look at the mechanism of the intermediates. Say the electrophile adds ortho See, it adds meta. It adds para.
this step of it adding to electrophile represents the rate determining step, because the hardest thing to do is to break that aromaticity the first time. The other step, restoring it, is just downhill. Okay? So, the more stable that intermediate is, the easier it is to break that aromaticity. Why is the intermediates for ortho and para better than meta? Because there's a, yes, because there is a tertiary carbocation. It has the better resonance structure due to that tertiary carbocation. So ortho and para are lower energy than meta is. Okay? If you have an electron donating group, and we're running out of time, so we'll probably pick this up on Friday, but if you have an electron donating group, you just swap. If you have an electron donating group, you have, it goes even faster because you have an additional resonance structure. If you have a carbonyl, yes, you can draw a tertiary carbocation that way, okay? But this is a case of the tertiary carbocation not being a good resonance structure. The carbonyl group is an electron withdrawing group, right? The last thing a carbocation wants is to be next to an electron withdrawing group. This is an example of resonance destabilization, because that electron withdrawing group next to that carbocation is actually destabilizing that carbocation. One last thing mentioned at the beginning of class. There's voter registration outside the lecture hall. If you're eligible to vote and haven't registered yet, please consider doing things. If you like the way things are being run, go out and vote. If you don't like the way things are being run, go out and vote. Those are the only two options. Go out and vote. There is a primary election April 7th. You might think that there's nothing to vote on a primary, but in Wisconsin, as you might know, that's the Supreme Court. That's when that Supreme Court's going to be decided. So, go out and vote.